three people from the LGBTQ community and three Christians enter a film studio to discuss their spiritual beliefs. No, this isn't the beginning to one of your uncle's offensive jokes. This happened, and let's talk about it. Okay, so before we dig into the actual video, I just want to bring up with this one point. Way back, maybe Christians were responding to this idea of just being totally immersed in the world, right? Having friends that were non-Christians, taking in media that just wasn't good. And so they really emphasized a lot of what I experienced was this emphasis on, hey, be careful who you hang out with, be careful who your friends are. Obviously, be careful what media you take in, but it was all kind of in this package of be careful, be discerning, and maybe it's not best we have non-Christian friends to, you know, close non-Christian friends and maybe just kind of back off that a little bit. And I think we've gone into another ditch where almost intimidated or scared in some ways of engaging in these kinds of conversations with people that may disagree with us. And I think, you know, it's awesome for us as Christians to be able to say, hey, look, I disagree with you, but I still love you. I still want to hear about your life. I still want to try to, you know, help and minister to you where you are, even if we don't agree on the same things. I just think it's so sad when we cut ourselves off to those kind of, you know, friendships just because we disagree with people. So I think this is a great idea of sitting down and talking with people you might not see eye to eye with. Let's dig into it.
There are times when I feel uncomfortable expressing my views around sexuality.
I get uncomfortable primarily because the bromance of like, well, there's two girls, who's the boy? And then it really just breaks the ice as it's like, there isn't supposed to be a boy. That's why we're there. I do my best to break the ice with the comedic deflection, which I've learned is a self-defense mechanism.
So I'm a pastor as well. I'm also a community leader in Boyle Heights. And in that community, there's a large LGBTQ presence. So there's that fear of really coming out and say what I believe, because I do love everybody and I don't want to be pushed to the side just because I have a certain feeling about, you know, any topic really.
You know, I think we need to be careful, and this video, you know, does some good things here. But it also kind of paints Christians and LGBTQ people as kind of enemies in a way. Just the nature of making a video like this, and even my video too. Like, you may see LGBTQ versus, you know, Christians, who will win, battle it out, you know, kind of thing. On a real, like, relational level, when I sit down with somebody, you know, and say, and they're maybe from the LGBTQ community, what are the things that are coming out of my mouth? Is it total like, yo, I hate you, you need to change, God hates you, you know, you're going to hell? Or is it, hey, let's sit down, let's talk about this, right? I don't hate you, I disagree with you. I think the Bible teaches something very different from your lifestyle, but I'm not just gonna bang it over the head, their head, right? Because they're a person. How would you, you know, respond to somebody coming into your life and saying, hey, how you live your life, what you, you know, your identity is totally wrong, and all these struggles that you've had in your life, they mean nothing to me, and I'm just gonna push down what I, you know, what I want to tell you. And that can be just really, in a sense, like, insensitive. Obviously, you want to share the truth. You don't want to cover up the truth just because you're scared of hurting their feelings. But at the same time, look, there's wisdom to growing and understanding, right? Growing and understanding of what they've been through, what their experience has been. Both these people talk about, you know, both the Christian and the you know, lesbian lady. They talk about how there's some hesitancy in sharing their views just because there's so much hostility when you do state what you believe. From their perspective, from somebody from the LGBTQ community, they very well may have been suppressing this their whole life, and then finally, you know, honed in on what they believe their identity is, and now you're coming in and telling them that's not right. So there needs to be a great level of sensitivity there. And I think the more people in our lives that resemble the culture as opposed to just our little, you know, our small little group of Christians, as we start having people that have these different beliefs, we're going to learn how to navigate these relationships better and speak truth and love to them.
some sins are worse than others.
In the eyes of, you know, of the God I worship, I believe that any sin separates us from Him because He's holy and pure. But at the same time, I think there are certain sins that will have greater consequences.
Yeah, I resonate with that. For me, it would be, you know, killing another human is the worst. Yeah. That's it. Also, it Venn diagrams into abortion. Taking the life of another is huge, is huge.
Can I ask you two this? Do you all see homosexuality as a sin?
Yes.
And if so, where on that scale?
I don't think a homosexual tendency or an attraction to somebody of the same gender is a sin. I think that's a natural feeling. I think when you start engaging in a lifestyle and you act upon that tendency, then because it goes against what I believe God designed, then I think that's clearly a sin.
Okay, wow, there's a lot to get to there. Okay, are some sins worse than others? This is a really interesting question because I think we can, I know I've had the tendency to minimize, maybe put all sins into, you know, one bucket in a sense. You know, there's a verse in James, if you stumble at one point, you're guilty of all of it. So this idea that, hey, you break one law, you're guilty of all of it. So in a sense, you know, all sins are kind of equal. And I think, and I'm going to kind of explore that, but I do want to say that some sins have worse effects, obviously, right? So if I watched a John Piper video about this, if you shoot somebody, right, versus if you spit on somebody, it's going to have different effect, right? It's still a sin. It's still wrong, right? Because you're still, you know, Jesus said, whoever hates his brother is a murderer, but the effect was different. So in a sense of what the effect was, well, the effect of murder was worse. And it's also important to point out that Jesus did say that there is degrees of punishment, right? So if you know what is right and don't do it, your punishment is going to be greater than somebody who didn't even know. But in context to how good God is, you know, all offenses are infinite offenses against God because He is so holy, because He is so good, because He is so just. Every time we make, you know, any kind of sin or mistake or whatever, that is an infinite offense against God. I think we want to be careful to not start putting ourselves on some sort of pedestal and say, oh, well, I'm a sinner, but I'm not as bad as that sinner because they're doing these things, because they're a murderer, because they're a homosexual, or because they're, you know, whatever it is. Like that, and I think that is, that's what this question is getting at, because they're seeing, look, do Christians think they're better than homosexuals? Like, do they think that they're not as big as sinners as homosexuals? And I think we got to be careful there, because yes, there are some sins that have worse effect, and right, and there is going to be greater judgment for some sins, but in the scope of eternity, in the scope of who God is, we are all broken, we are all sinful, and we are all in need of redemption.
I just don't believe in sin because I feel that sometimes being punitive about things can like make you repress things, and like instinctually I was like, but not acting on them would be a sin. Like that's how it feels for me, like being dishonest to myself, that feels wrong.
Okay, this idea, she says here, being dishonest to myself feels like a sin. That was her like natural inclination to say, you know, if you stop yourself from doing something that you feel like you want to do, you feel like you have a tendency for, then to repress yourself from that, in her kind of moral worldview, that would almost be an immoral thing to do. So it's like this idea of self-actualization, you know, becoming what we are capable of. It comes from kind of a humanistic worldview. And it gets into this idea of a couple things here: identity, authenticity. You know, what do all these things mean for us here? For her to be authentic would be to, you know, just be who she feels like she is, what she wants to do, doing those things, following those desires. That would be authentic to her, and that would kind of, you know, bring forth this self-actualization where she becomes fully herself and is fully fulfilled. And this idea of authenticity is really tied into our identity. So, you know, this is why I think it's so important for us to talk to people from the LGBTQ community, and not just shout or not just, you know, post, you know, Facebook message. Like, let's sit down and have conversations with people that we meet that are in our lives. It's an identity issue, right? This stuff goes deep. This is who they believe they are. Like, this is a core aspect to their being in this other identity that maybe they had been suppressing for a while. But now, you know, perhaps they feel free, like they've established freedom. It's not true freedom, because we know true freedom comes from the freedom that we have in Christ, free from sin. It kind of feels like freedom to them, because now they can go in on those impulses that they had been suppressing. And now you're coming in and saying, hey, no, these things are wrong. It's all an identity issue. But let's not think that this is just their issue with identity. Like, you gotta be able to look back, you know, maybe if you're a Christian, before you were a Christian, and see where your identity was tied up in. And oftentimes, it can be a couple different things on the surface, but it is our flesh, right? The Bible talks a lot about our flesh and our sinful nature. We find identity in the things that our flesh kind of guides us to, whether that's like looking for approval or our job or achievement or, you know, our sexuality or whatever that is. Our flesh is guiding us and leading us towards following our desires, and then we put our identity in those things, and that's where we find our, you know, our sense of meaning and purpose and belonging. Okay, reading here from John 8, verse 7. For the mind that is set on the flesh is hostile to God, for it does not submit to God's law. Indeed, it cannot. Those who are in the flesh cannot please God. You, however, are not in the flesh, but in the Spirit. In fact, the Spirit of God dwells in you. The flesh, or that are like our desires, right, are hostile to God. That's what that verse is saying, right? They're hostile to God, and that's a very the big shift in a lot of people's worldviews, because a lot of people think, hey, we're good people. Most people are good people and they're trying to do what's right. And they would almost think that our flesh or our natural propensity, you know, is towards God and towards doing good things. But the Bible says, no, it's not actually. We're dead in our trespasses and sins. You know, we can't please God on our own doing. Our good works are like filthy rags to God. And maybe you're like, Isaac, well, why don't you bring up all those verses about homosexuality and stuff like that? Well, I could do that, but I'm talking generally about everyone, because even if, you know, if you're not a Christian, whether you're, you know, in the LGBTQ community or not, you have a worship issue. You're worshiping things that are not of God. You're worshiping your flesh. You're following your flesh. And the Bible says the flesh is actually hostile to God. So what are we going to do about it? Okay, this is Romans 6:6 here. So it says, we know that our old self was crucified with him in order that the body of sin might be brought to nothing, so that we would no longer be enslaved to sin. The idea that we are free when we are just following our passions, our flesh, or doing what feels good to us, that idea that that is free, that's so counter to reality, because in fact we're in bondage to our sin, and you can feel it. You can sense that when we're in bondage to the things that are actually going to lead us astray. And often we won't see it now. We don't see the things leading us down the road to destruction. Like, you think about an addiction to pornography. It feels freeing to be able to just watch what you want when you want to. But those things have consequences, not only on the immediate right now, our relationships, our interactions, but also ultimately spiritually, and how we're going to be judged and held accountable for those things. So in 2 Corinthians 5:17, it says, therefore, if anyone is in Christ, he is a new creation. The old has passed away. Behold, the new has come. It's all by the power of God. You know, the amazing thing is that Jesus came to give himself for our sins. So we don't have to be held accountable for what we did, because he has given his life for us. And now we can be indwelt with the Holy Spirit. You know, the flesh, we were once following the flesh and the desires of the flesh and just doing what we want. And a lot of us had that same worldview of that lady and saying, hey, it's almost a sin to not do what we want. That's how we almost see it. But now God transforms, and he can transform your heart and turn it towards him. And you can be indwelt by the Holy Spirit. Now you don't walk in the desires of the flesh. No, you walk by the Spirit. Thanks so much for watching, guys. I so appreciate you. I hope you liked this video, and give it a like down below if you did. Subscribe to the channel because I'm creating new videos every single week. Once again, you can head on over to Patreon to support me on there. It'd be a humongous blessing. Thanks so much for watching, guys, and I'll see you next time.